So till now, we have considered the second law of thermodynamics that was dealing with the thermodynamic cycles. Yes, it is an important and useful approach. But even then, we are often concerned with processes rather than cycles. Therefore, we are interested in the second law analysis of the processes we encounter daily, like the combustion of process in automobile engine, or the cooling of a cup of tea, or the chemical processes that take place in our body. So we want to deal with the second law quantitatively as well as qualitatively. While discussing the first law, we initially stated that law in a terms of cycle, but then defined a property which was known as the internal energy. And this property enabled us to see or to use the first law quantitatively for processes. Similarly, the second law has been stated for a cycle during previous lectures. And now we look forward to see that the second law leads to a property entropy, which enables us to treat the second law quantitatively for the processes. Energy and entropy are both abstract concepts that help to describe certain observations. So that is why sometimes thermodynamics is described as the science of energy and. So in this lecture, we will be basically dealing with the clauses inequality and entropy. The inequality of clauses is basically the corollary, or you can say consequence, of the second law of thermodynamics. And we will demonstrate for all the possible cycles, whether reversible cycles or irreversible cycles, whether heat engine cycles or refrigerator cycles, that cyclic integral of del Q upon T is less than equal to zero for all the possible signs of cyclic integral of Q. What could be the possible sign of cyclic integral of del Q? It could be positive, it could be equal to zero, or it could be negative. So for all the possible sign of del Q, that is cyclic integral of del Q, we are having the cyclic integral of del Q upon T either equal to zero or less than zero. This is what we are going to demonstrate mathematically or conceptually. Now, any reversible cycle can be represented by a series of Carnot cycle. And in this analysis, we need consider only a Carnot cycle that leads to inequality of clauses. So first of all, we will consider a reversible, that is Carnot heat engine cycle, operating between reservoirs at temperature TH and TL. So we consider first a reversible Carnot heat engine cycle, which is operating between reservoirs at temperature TH. And for this, the cyclic integral of the heat transfer, that is del Q, is greater than zero. Now, as the temperature reservoirs are having fixed temperature, means they are maintained. From the definition of absolute temperature scale, and also from the fact that it is a reversible cycle, we can say QH upon QL is equal to TH upon TL. Therefore, del Q upon T, will be equal to QH upon TH minus QL upon TL, that will be equal to zero. Now, since we are saying the cyclic integral of del q upon t, it means we will use this term for all the reservoirs present in our consideration. Since there are two reservoirs only, one having the temperature TH and one having the temperature TL. And mind it, for the heat transfer, we have to include the sign of the heat transfer as per convention, means heat given to the system, means absorbed by the working fluid or working substance will be taken as positive, whereas heat rejected by the working fluid or you say by the system, rejected by the system will be taken as negative. So here QH was positive because it was the heat absorbed by the working fluid or working substance, and QL was the heat rejected by the working substance. And since QH upon TH is equal to QL upon TL, so this cyclic integral of del Q upon T, this expression becomes equal to 0. Now, if anyhow the cyclic integral of heat transfer del Q, cyclic integral of del Q approaches 0, that can be done by making TH approaching TL, and the cycle remains reversible. The cyclic integral of del Q upon T remains 0. So we can say for all reversible heat engine cycles, the cyclic integral of del Q will be 0, and the cyclic integral of del Q upon T will be also 0. Now we consider a reversible heat engine cycle operating between the same temperatures TH and TL as reversible engines and receiving the same quantity QH. So what we assume? We assume that a reversible heat engine is operating between the same temperature limits, that is TH and TL. And moreover, heat supplied to the working substance or heat given to the working system means heat supplied from the TH to the irreversible heat engine is the same, that is QH, as it was in the case of reversible engine. Now we compare the irreversible cycle with the reversible one. So what we can conclude that in the case of irreversible engine, we will have less efficiency as compared to that of reversible one. So efficiency of irreversible engine is less than reversible engine. Now the formula in terms of work and heat supplied is given for the reversible as well as irreversible. Now QH is same for both the cases. So what one can infer? That work produced by irreversible engine will be less than that of reversible case for the same heat supplied, that is QH. Okay, so this we have put over here, work produced by irreversible engine is less than the work produced by reversible engine. Now, as W is equal to QH minus QL for both reversible and irreversible cycles, so we can say QH minus QL irreversible is less than QH minus QL reversible, right? So QH will get cancelled, and we will multiply both the terms by minus 1. So what will happen? The sign will get reversed, means sign will change its direction, inequality sign will change its direction. So what we get? QL irreversible is greater than the QL reversible. It means the heat rejected by the irreversible engine is more than the heat rejected by the reversible heat engine. Now, for the irreversible cycle engine, if we want to analyze the cyclic integral of del Q, that will be minus QL irreversible, and that will be positive. That will be positive. Now, The cyclic integral of del q upon t will be qh upon th minus ql irreversible upon tl, which will be negative. Why? Because when we were having ql in place of ql irreversible, then it was 0. Now the value of ql irreversible is more than the value of ql. Hence it will become negative. Hence it will become negative. I think this is clear. Now, if we make the engine to become more and more irreversible, keeping QH, TH and TL fixed, the cyclic integral of heat transfer, that is the cyclic integral of del Q, approaches 0, and the cyclic integral of del Q upon T becomes a larger negative value. Now, what could be the limiting value of work output and what could be the limiting value of cyclic integral of heat transfer? Now, as the engine becomes irreversible, the value of QL irreversible means the heat rejected, the magnitude of heat rejected by the engine increases for the same amount of heat supplied, keeping TH and TL fixed. So what will happen? A limit will come when the value of QL irreversible will be equal to the value of QH, and in that case work output will become 0, and moreover the cyclic integral of heat transfer will also become equal to 0. Now here for irreversible engine, the cyclic integral of del q upon t will remain negative and it would never become equal to 0. So we can conclude that for all irreversible heat engine cycles, the cyclic integral of heat transfer is equal to or greater than 0, and the cyclic integral of del q upon t will be a negative value, that is less than 0. To demonstrate Clausius inequality for refrigerator, we consider reversible and irreversible refrigeration cycles operating between reservoirs at temperature TL and TH. Now for the reversible refrigeration cycle, you can say the cyclic integral of heat transfer, which is equal to minus QH plus QL, is less than 0. For any refrigerator, whether it is reversible or irreversible, you know that QH represents the amount of heat rejected by the working substance, and moreover it is having a greater magnitude than QL because QL plus W is equal to QH. So for any refrigerator, the cyclic integral of heat transfer will be negative, and so is for the reversible refrigerator cycle in any normal case. Now for the reversible refrigeration cycle, you can say QH upon QL is equal to TH upon TL. So the cyclic integral of del Q upon T will become equal to 0. Now the cyclic integral of heat transfer, it may approach 0 by making TH approaching TL. So in the limiting case, the cyclic integral of heat transfer becomes 0 for the reversible refrigerator. And as proved on the slide, the cyclic integral of del Q upon T will always remain 0 for the reversible refrigerator. So we can say for the reversible refrigerators, we can say the cyclic integral of heat transfer is 0, as well as the cyclic integral of del Q upon T is also equal to 0. Now we consider a irreversible refrigerator cycle that is operating between the same temperatures, that is TH and TL, and receiving the same amount of QL as the reversible refrigerator. Now we compare the irreversible cycle with the reversible one, and we can conclude that work input required will be greater for the irreversible refrigerator. Now you can see the formula for the COP for the reversible refrigerator as well as irreversible refrigerator. Now QL is same for both the cases. So we can say that work in input required will be greater for the irreversible refrigerator as COP of irreversible refrigerator is always less than the COP of reversible refrigerator. So now, since work input required for irreversible refrigerator is greater than the work input required for the reversible refrigerator, and W is equal to QH minus QL, you can say QH irreversible minus QL is greater than QH reversible minus QL. So this basically yields the result QH irreversible is greater than QH reversible. It means if the two refrigerators, one is reversible and another is irreversible, they are operating between the same temperature limits, that is TH and TL, then and also receiving the same amount of QL, then QH, that is amount of heat rejected for irreversible, will be greater than the amount of heat rejected by the reversible refrigerator. Now for the irreversible refrigerator, minus QH irreversible plus QL, which is basically the cyclic integral of heat transfer, that will be a negative value and it will never become equal to zero, because as the irreversibility increases, the magnitude of QH irreversible will increase, and hence this expression, that is cyclic integral of heat transfer, will always become negative and negative. Now the cyclic integral of del Q upon T is equal to minus QH irreversible upon TH plus QL upon TL. That will also have negative value, because when we were having QH upon TH, which was for the case of reversible cycle, this expression was equal to zero. Now because QH irreversible is more than the QH for the reversible case, so this expression will have negative value. The limiting case as the cyclic integral of del Q approaches zero never exists for the irreversible refrigerator. So for all the irreversible refrigerator, we can say the cyclic integral of heat transfer is negative value, and the cyclic integral of del Q upon T is also having negative value, that is less than zero. So we can summarize that for all the signs of the del Q, that is cyclic integral of del Q, which may be a positive, which may be negative, which may be equal to zero, for each of the reversible cycles, we are having del Q upon T is equal to zero, means cyclic integral of del Q upon T will be equal to zero. So we have considered all the possible cycles, reversible and irreversible one, heat engine cycles and the refrigerator cycles. Now for the possible irreversible cycles, means for all the signs of cyclic integral of del Q, which may be equal to greater than or less than equal to zero, we will be having the cyclic integral of del Q upon T in negative value, means less than zero. So for all cycles, whether they are heat engine cycles or refrigerator cycles, whether they are reversible cycles or irreversible cycles, the cyclic integral of del Q upon T is less than equal to zero. This is the Clausius inequality that we have demonstrated for all the possible cycles, that is for the reverse cycles, for the irreversible cycles, for the heat engine cycles, for the refrigerator cycles. Now we want to demonstrate that the second law of thermodynamics leads to a property of system which we call entropy. So for that, we assume a control mass, which is basically the system. Control mass means fixed mass. So basically, the system which is comprising of a fixed mass or a control mass is undergoing a reversible process from state 1 to state 2 along path A, and the cycle is completed along path B, and process A as well as process B both are reversible. Henceforth, the cycle will also be a reversible, which is constituted by process A and B. So we can say the cyclic integral of डेल क्यू अपॉन टी फॉर ए रिवर्सिबल साइकिल विल बी इक्वल टू जीरो. सो वी हैव एक्सप्रेस्ड बाई दिस एक्सप्रेशन नंबर वन ऑन द स्लाइड. नाउ वी कंसिडर अनदर रिवर्सिबल साइकिल विच प्रोसीड्स फर्स्ट अलॉन्ग पाथ सी फ्रॉम स्टेट वन टू स्टेट टू एंड द साइकिल इज कंप्लीटेड अलॉन्ग पाथ बी. नाउ प्रोसेस सी एज वेल एज प्रोसेस बी बोथ आर रिवर्सिबल. सो अगेन वी कैन से द साइक्लिक इंटीग्रल ऑफ डेल क्यू अपॉन टी विल बी इक्वल टू जीरो एंड दैट हैज बीन एक्सप्रेस्ड बाई द एक्सप्रेशन सेकेंड ऑन द स्लाइड. नाउ सब्ट्रैक्टिंग द सेकेंड इक्वेशन फ्रॉम द फर्स्ट वी गेट डेल क्यू अपॉन टी फॉर प्रोसेस ए वाइल द प्रोसेस इज प्रोसीडिंग फ्रॉम स्टेट वन टू टू इज इक्वल टू डेल क्यू अपॉन टी फॉर द पाथ सी वेन द प्रोसेस इज प्रोसीडिंग फ्रॉम स्टेट वन टू टू. सो वी कैन से दैट फॉर बोथ द सेम एंड स्टेट दैट इज फ्रॉम वन टू टू डेल क्यू अपॉन टी फॉर ए प्रोसेस विल बी इक्वल टू डेल क्यू अपॉन टी फॉर सी प्रोसेस. सो इट मीन्स दिस प्रॉपर्टी और दिस टर्म इज नॉट डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द पाथ फॉर द गिवन एंड स्टेट्स. मीन्स इट इज बेसिकली ए पॉइंट फंक्शन, इट इज बेसिकली ए प्रॉपर्टी. सो वी गिव नेम टू दिस टर्म एज द चेंज ऑफ एंट्रोपी. दैट इज वाई यू मस्ट हैव रेड अप टू क्लास 12 दैट चेंज ऑफ एंट्रोपी इज इक्वल टू डेल क्यू अपॉन टी फॉर ए रिवर्सिबल प्रोसेस. सो वी हैव डेजिग्नेटेड डेल क्यू अपॉन टी एज एन इंपॉर्टेंट प्रॉपर्टी दैट इज द चेंज ऑफ एंट्रोपी. एंट्रोपी इज बेसिकली एन एक्सटेंसिव प्रॉपर्टी एंड एंट्रोपी पर यूनिट मास इज designated with small s. So it is important to note here that entropy is defined here in the terms of a reversible process, as I have told you earlier also. And the change of entropy of a system as it undergoes change of state is denoted by s2 minus s1 integration from 1 to 2 del q upon t for a reversible process. So means if we have to perform the integration, we must know the relation between T and Q. Since entropy is a property, the change in entropy of the substance in going from one state to another is same for all the processes, both reversible and irreversible between the two states. So basically, this expression enables us to determine changes of entropy, but it does not tell anything about the absolute values of property. So from third law of thermodynamics, we come to know that entropy of all pure substances can be assigned the value of zero at the absolute zero of temperature. Okay, so one thing is clear that since entropy is a property, the change of entropy is a property, so change of entropy is going to be the same for both the processes, that is reversible as well as reversible. Now in the case of reversible, this change of entropy will be equal to del q upon t for reversible process, whereas for the irreversible process the change of entropy will not be equal to del q upon t for irreversible process, but the change of property ds is going to remain the same for both the processes, reversible and irreversible, as far as their change of states or end states are the same. Now you must be noting one thing, that entropy is a property point function, whereas del q is basically a path function, heat transfer is a path function. So del q is represented by inexact differential, whereas the entropy is designated with exact differential, that is by ds. From mathematical point of view, we can say that an inexact differential can be converted to an exact differential by introduction of an integrating factor. So basically this 1 upon t is serving as a integrating factor, is acting as a integrating factor in converting the inexact differential that is del q to the exact differential that is ds. Many times property diagram serve as great visual aids in thermodynamic analysis of the process. Though we have used PV and TS diagrams and TEV diagrams in previous chapters also in conjunction with the first law of thermodynamics. Now, in second law also analysis also, it is very helpful to plot the processes on diagrams for which one of the coordinates is entropy. So the two diagrams commonly used in second law analysis are the temperature entropy, that is TS diagram, and the enthalpy entropy diagram, that is HS diagram. So from the expression 1, ds is equal to del q upon t for reversible process, we can say that del q is equal to tds. So as del q is corresponding to differential area on TS diagram, so the total heat transfer during an internally reversible process is determined by integration of TDS. So basically, it corresponds to the area under the process curve on TS diagram. So on the diagram, on the slide, we are showing you the process, and the area under this curve will basically represent the heat transfer because that is equal to integration of TDS. So we can conclude that the area under the process curve on a TS diagram represents the heat transfer during an internally reversible process. Now, this is somewhat analogous to reversible boundary work being represented by the area under the process curve on PV diagram. The area under the process curve represents the heat transfer for the processes that are internally or totally reversible. This area has no meaning for the irreversible process. Now it has been established that entropy is a thermodynamic property of a system and it is bearing a great significance in various processes. If we take the example of Carnot cycle, which is consisting of basically reversible processes, that is reversible isothermal processes as the heat transfer processes and the reversible adiabatic processes, which is basically the reversible adiabatic expansion and reversible adiabatic compression. Now, the working substance of heat engine operating on Carnot cycle is making up the system. Now, the first process is isothermal transfer of heat to the working fluid from the high temperature reservoir. For this, we can write S2 minus S1 is equal to del Q upon T for a reversible process integrated from 1 to 2. Since it is a reversible process, the equation can be integrated to give 1 Q 2 upon TH because TH was the constant and it was taken out of the integration sign. Now the area underlying 1 2, that is area 1 2 BA1, basically represents the heat transfer to the working substance during this process. Now process 2 to 3 is reversible adiabatic. So for this you write ds is equal to del Q upon T REV, that is reversible process. Now it is clearly seen that entropy remains constant in a reversible adiabatic process, as I have told you, and we are going to prove in subsequent lectures also that a process which is reversible as well as adiabatic is an isentropic process. That is why it is shown with the help of a vertical line on TS diagram. Now the third process is reversible isothermal process in which heat is transferred from the working substance to the low temperature reservoir. For this process also we have written the expression S4 minus S3 is equal to 3Q4 upon TL. Now here the area under the line 3-4 is basically representing or is denoting the heat rejected from the working substance to the low temperature reservoir. So basically, the area under 43BA4 is representing the amount QL. Now, the process 4 to 1 is basically a reversible adiabatic process and therefore isentropic, and it is evident that entropy decrease in the process 3 4 must be exactly equal to the entropy increase in the process 1 to 2. So the area underlying 3 4, that is area 3 4, AB3, is representing the amount rejected from the working fluid to the low temperature reservoir, as I've told you now. So the efficiency is equal to net work upon heat supplied. Now the net work of the cycle is equal to the net heat transfer. The area 1 2 3 4 1 is representing the net work of the cycle. So the efficiency has been represented by the expression shown on the last of the slide. Now we want to discuss the entropy change of control mass during an irreversible process. So we consider a system consisting of control mass or fixed mass that is undergoing irreversible process from state 1 to 2 along path A, and it is restoring back to its initial state through path B. Now A is reversible as well as B is reversible. As both the processes are reversible, the cycle will also be reversible. So we have applied the Clausius inequality given for reversible cycle, shown by the expression 1 on the slide. Now instead of path A, if the change of state from 1 to 2 is made by path C, which is irreversible, and returning back to initial state through path B, which is reversible, so the cycle will be irreversible one. If any of the process in a cycle is irreversible, the cycle will be irreversible. So we have applied the Clausius inequality given for irreversible cycle, which we have discussed earlier. So that is shown by the expression 2 on the, or the second expression on the slide. Now subtracting the expression from the first and rearranging, we get the third expression on the slide, and that is del Q upon T for A process is greater than del Q upon T for the C process for the same end states. Since path A is reversible and since entropy is a property, so we can say the change of property for path A is equal to change of property for path C. Henceforth, DSA is equal to DSC for the same end states. Now, since path A is reversible, we can say DSA is equal to del Q upon T for A path for the end states, that is 1 to 2. And now, if we substitute this value, that is DSC, in the third expression shown on the previous slide, we will get this result that DSC is greater than del Q upon T for path C for the end states 1 to 2. As the C path was arbitrary, we can say that change of entropy for irreversible process is greater than del Q upon T for that process, that is irreversible. So we can conclude that change of entropy for any process, whether reversible or irreversible, is equal to del Q upon T for that process. Equality sign holds for the reversible process, whereas inequality sign holds for the irreversible process. If the amount del Q is transferred to a control mass at a temperature T in a reversible process, the change of entropy is given by this relation. That is, change of entropy is equal to del Q upon T for reversible process. If any irreversible effects occur while the amount of heat del Q is transferred to a control mass at temperature T, the change in entropy will be greater than for the reversible process. And in that case, we would write dS is greater than del Q upon T. The above equation hold good when del Q is equal to 0, when del Q is negative, and when del Q is greater than 0. If del Q is negative, the entropy will tend to decrease as the result of heat transfer. However, the influence of irreversibilities is still to increase the entropy of the mass, and from absolute numerical perspective, we can write the change of entropy is greater than equal to del Q upon T. Now we want to derive the expression for the entropy changes for a closed system that is containing an ideal gas. So for that, we have assumed a unit mass of an ideal gas that is undergoing reversible process, for which the first law of thermodynamics may be expressed as del Q is equal to del U plus del W. Now for an ideal gas, the state equation is equal to P into V is equal to RT. The change in internal energy is given by the expression D is equal to CV dT for ideal gas, and the boundary movement work is given by del W is equal to PdV. Now the first law of thermodynamics for the closed system can be rewritten as del Q is equal to CV dT plus PdV. Now dividing both sides by T, we get this expression del Q upon T is equal to CV dT upon T plus PdV upon T. Now for a reversible process, as by the definition, we can write dS is equal to del Q upon T. So the equation written on the top of the slide can now rewritten as dS is equal to CV dT upon T plus PdV upon T. Now P upon T can be substituted by R upon V. Now integrating both sides, we get the expression shown on the last of the slide, which is expressing the change of entropy per unit mass when both the temperatures, that is initial temperature and final temperature, as well as initial and final specific volume of ideal, are given along with the value of CV and CR. Now according to the gas equation, we can have P1V1 upon T1 is equal to P2V2 upon T2. So T2 upon T1 equals to P2 upon P1 into V2 upon V1. Now substituting the value of T2 upon T1 in the equation shown on the last slide, we can write and we get the expression S2 minus S1 is equal to CV into natural log of P2 V2 upon P1 V1 plus R ln of V2 upon V1. Now simplifying, we get the expression S2 minus S1 is equal to CV into natural log of P2 upon P1 plus CV plus R ln of V2 upon V1, which is the second last expression on the slide. So finally, as we know that CV plus R is equal to CP, so the last expression is the S2 minus S1 is equal to CV ln of P2 upon P1 plus CP ln of V2 upon V1. Now again from gas equation, we can have the value of V2 upon V1 is equal to P1 T2 upon P2 T1. Now substituting this value in the equation 2.115, we get the expression for the specific entropy change in terms of temperatures and pressures, which is shown by the equation 2.117 on the slide. Now we want to derive the expression for the entropy change for an ideal gas undergoing polytropic process. As found in many processes in practice, that we have to approximate a reversible law of the form P into V raised to power n is equal to constant, where n is a constant. Both vapor and perfect gases obey this law, this type of law, in many non-flow processes. Now the first law of thermodynamics for a unit mass of reversible non-flow polytropic process can be expressed as del Q is equal to du plus del W. Now du is written in the form of CV dT, whereas the boundary movement work is defined as PdV. Now here the boundary movement work PdV, so in place of P we have written C upon Vn, as this boundary movement work is for polytropic process. So integrating this expression, we can get the value of boundary movement work for the polytropic process. Now we know that CV is equal to R upon gamma minus 1. Now del Q is equal to R into T2 minus T1 upon gamma minus 1, and the term for polytropic work will be P1 V1 minus P2 V2 upon N minus 1. Now del Q is equal to P2 V2 minus P1 V1 gamma minus 1 plus P1 V1 minus P2 V2 upon N minus 1. The first term on the right hand side is written as P2 V2 minus P1 V1 because RT2 is equal to P2 V2 and RT1 is equal to P1 V1. Now we have taken P1 V1 minus P2 V2 as common factor on the right hand side, and we get the expression as expressed by the equation 2.118 or the above expression, that is gamma minus n upon gamma minus 1 into P1 V1 minus P2 V2 upon n minus 1. So this expression can be expressed also by the equation 2.118 because the bracketed term is basically the boundary movement work for the polytropic process. Now for an ideal gas, we can say PV is equal to RT as the form of state equation. Now we substitute the value of P upon T as R upon V in the expression because we have divided the equation 2.118 by T, and del Q upon T has been equal to DS. So now if you see the second last expression, we are integrating both sides from state 1 to state 2. Now integrating this expression, we get the expression that is 2.119 equation, which is S2 minus S1 is equal to gamma minus n upon gamma minus 1 into R into natural log of V2 upon V1, which is the expression for the entropy change per unit mass for an ideal gas for a polytropic process. Now for the polytropic process, the relation between temperature and volume is given by the expression 2.120. So substituting these value in the expression which we have derived earlier for the entropy change for an ideal gas for a polytropic process, we obtain after simplification the last expression shown on the slide in the terms of temperature. So that is S2 minus S1 is equal to Cv into n minus gamma upon n minus 1 into natural log of T2 upon T1. Now it is basically the proof of the fact that a process which is reversible and adiabatic is isentropic. This sentence I have used many times, and I promised you that in one of the lectures we will prove that a process which is reversible as well as adiabatic is isentropic, or you can say a process which is adiabatic and isentropic, it is nothing but a reversible process. So now we are going to prove it. So we consider a unit mass of an ideal gas undergoing a non-flow process, for which the first law may be expressed as given on this first equation or first expression on the slide, that is del Q is equal to du plus del W, where del W is equal to PdV because it is a boundary movement work. Now for a reversible process, so first assumption have come up, that is we have assumed the process to be a reversible. So for that we have written del Q is equal to TdS by the definition. Now first law can be written as TdS is equal to du plus PdV, which is equal to CvdT plus PdV. Now for an ideal gas, as the form of a state equation, we can say PV is equal to RT. Now differentiating both sides for the variables P, V and T, we get PdV plus VdP is equal to RdT. Now DT is equal to PdV plus VdP upon R. Now the second assumption comes up, that is we have assumed the process to be isentropic, so we say DS is equal to 0. So what is going to happen? The left hand side will be equal to 0, will be put 0. So it says that right side is also equal to 0. Now R upon CV is equal to gamma. So we can say PdV plus VdP upon gamma minus 1 plus PdV is equal to 0. Now taking LCM, which is gamma minus 1, we get the expression PdV plus VdP plus gamma PdV minus PdV upon gamma minus 1 is equal to 0. Now here after simplifying we get VdP plus gamma PdV upon gamma minus 1 is equal to 0. Now this states that numerator is 0. So it says that VdP plus gamma PdV is equal to 0. Now dividing both sides by PV, we get the expression shown by 2.124 equation. Now integrating, we get log of P plus gamma times log of V is equal to log of C. All these logarithms are to the base E. Now, after simplifying it, we get P into V raised to power gamma is equal to constant. So, as we have discussed earlier in some of the previous slides, that the entropy change for an irreversible process is larger than the change in a reversible process for the same del Q and T, that is absolute temperature. And here in the equation form, it can be written as shown on the slide by the equation 2.125. Here we have changed the inequality sign with an equality. So definitely we have added something on the side which was having lower magnitude. So it means ds was greater than del q upon t. So to change this inequality into equality, what we have done, ds is equal to del q upon t plus something, and this something is nothing but entropy generated. So this term, the second term in this equation 2.125, is going to be a positive. The limiting value can be equal to 0, otherwise it has to be a positive value. Now the amount of entropy del S gen is the entropy generation in the process due to irreversibilities occurring inside the system. Now we have considered our system to be control mass. So the internal generation can be caused by the processes such as friction, unrestrained expansion, internal transfer of energy, that is redistribution over a finite temperature difference. In addition to this internal entropy generation, external irreversibilities are also possible by heat transfer over finite temperature differences, as the del Q, that is heat is transferred from a reservoir or by a mechanical transfer of work. Now, if we say that the second term in the equation 2.125 has to be positive, and its smallest value is possible in the reversible process, in which this term can be equal to 0. So now, from this, we may deduce some limits for heat transfer and work terms for an irreversible process. So first of all, we consider a reversible process for which entropy generation is 0, and the heat transfer and work transfer therefore are del Q is equal to TdS and del W is equal to PdV. So mind it, this del Q is equal to TdS is valid only for reversible process. Until and unless you assume the process to be reversible, you cannot say del Q is equal to TdS. And similar is for the expression for boundary movement work, that is del W. Del W is equal to PdV only when the process is reversible. Otherwise, it is not equal to PdV. Now, for an irreversible process with non-zero entropy generation, the heat transfer term will become del Q irreversible is equal to TdS minus T del S gen. This is nothing but this term has been derived from the equation 2.125. You rearrange the terms and you will get this. So here heat transfer del Q irreversible is less than del Q, which is for reversible process for the same change of state, that is DS. Okay, so for the heat transfer we have shown you that heat transfer for irreversible process is going to be lesser than as compared to that for reversible process. Now by the first law we can say del Q irreversible is equal to du plus del W irreversible. Now du being the property for the control mass, it is going to remain same for the reversible process as well as irreversible process. Du will not change with the path because it is a property, it is a point function. And the property relation is always valid, that is TdS is equal to du plus PdV. This property relation we will study in the next unit, that is Maxwell relations. But here you can understand it in this way, that in place of del Q we have written TdS, and in place of boundary movement work, that is del W, we have written PdV, and we got the one of the property relation. There are four property relations that we are going to study in the next unit, and one of them is TdS is equal to du plus PdV. Why it is known as property relation? Because every term here is a property, whether it is absolute temperature T, whether it is entropy S, whether it is internal energy U, whether it is pressure P, or whether it's volume V. Every term is a property, that is why it is known as property relation. Now, by substituting these all values, we get the value for irreversible work, that is equal to PdV minus T del S gen, showing that the work is reduced by an amount proportional to entropy generation. So here we come to know by the equation 2.127 that the work done for an irreversible process is less than that for reversible process, because for the reversible process work is equal to boundary movement work is equal to PdV, and for the irreversible process it is somewhat lesser than that. So that is why this term, second term in the equation 2.127, that is T into del S gen, that is often called as lost work. Although it is not a real work or energy quantity lost, but it is basically a lost opportunity to extract work. Means, had the process been reversible, we could have got work additional equal to this amount. But since the process is irreversible, we have lost that opportunity to extract that magnitude of work. That is why it is known as a lost opportunity to extract work. So now the above equation can be integrated between initial states and final states to get this S2 minus S1 is equal to integration of del Q upon T plus integration of entropy generation. Now we will discuss the important conclusions about entropy and irreversibilities that we have drawn from the expressions that we have derived or analyzed in the previous slides. I have written all the important expressions on the slide, the conclusions of which we are going to discuss now. So there are two ways in which entropy can be increased: by transferring heat to it. Means, if we want entropy to increase, as shown by the expression 1, that is equation number 2.125, then there are only two ways: when del Q is positive, or when the second term, that is del S gen, is positive. Del Q is positive, it means heat is being given to the system, that is control mass. Or the second alternative could be by having irreversibilities, that is having the second term equal to a positive term. If we want entropy to decrease, means if you want ds to become negative, there is only one way, that is by having del q to be negative, because del s gen, that is second term in the first expression, cannot be negative. And del q negative means, it means heat has to be taken away from the control mass or the system. For an adiabatic process, del q becomes zero. It means if there is an entropy increase, that is because of the second term. Means increase in entropy will then be associated with the irreversibilities if the process is adiabatic. Now, another important conclusion. We have studied that a process which is adiabatic and reversible is isentropic, and vice versa. Means if the process is isentropic and adiabatic, it has nothing, but it has to be reversible. But if the isentropic process is reversible, it is adiabatic, as I told you. Now we take up an example of an expansion of a hot fluid in a turbine, where the entropy decrease of the system due to heat loss to the surroundings, that is minus del q upon t, is equal to the entropy generation or entropy increase of the system due to internal irreversibility such as friction. So what is happening? There is entropy decrease due to heat loss to the surroundings, and if there is such limit that this entropy decrease due to heat loss is anyhow equal in magnitude to the entropy generation or the entropy increase of the system due to internal irreversibilities, then we can get a situation in which these two terms will make up a zero. Means they are equal in magnitude, and one is positive and another is negative, so they will make up a zero. So ds becomes zero. So in that condition, we can say that the process is isentropic, and but it is not reversible because it is not adiabatic. It was not adiabatic because there was heat loss involved, and there was also entropy generation due to friction and other factors associated with internal irreversibilities. So the process has anyhow become isentropic, but it is not adiabatic, so therefore it is not reversible. And the other thing, it is not reversible because entropy generation term is positive, that is del s gen is positive, it is not equal to zero. An adiabatic process need not be isentropic, since entropy can also increase due to friction, but if the process is adiabatic and reversible, it must be isentropic. So it is not necessary that an adiabatic process has to be isentropic, because the entropy increase is also attributed to friction. Means if del q is zero, then del s gen can be a positive term, and this will lead to have a ds equal to some positive quantity. So it means entropy will increase. But if the process is adiabatic, it means del q is zero, and the process is reversible too, means del s gen is also equal to zero, then ds will also be equal to zero, and hence the process will be isentropic. Now, as we have proved earlier, that in the case of irreversible process, the work done is less than that in case of reversible one. So basically, the presence of irreversibilities will cause the work to be smaller than the reversible work. So the work done in reversible process is the maximum one, And in the case of irreversible process, the work done by the control mass is less than that in case of reversible process. Now, in the case of expansion process, the work done in irreversible process is less than that of reversible one. Whereas in the case of compression processes, means which consume energy, then the irreversible work required is more than that in the case of reversible one. Now, as I told you earlier also, that in the case of boundary movement work, the boundary movement work is equal to integration of PdV only and only when the process is reversible. And also the heat transfer is equal to integration of TdS only and only when the process is reversible. When the process is irreversible, work done is not equal to integration PdV, and similarly the heat transfer is not equal to integration TdS. Therefore, the area underneath the path does not represent work and heat on PV and TS diagram respectively. So I have shown you here on the slide also that if you see the two diagrams on the slide marked as B, that is PV diagram and TS diagram. So the area under these curves are representing the work done in the case of PV diagram and the heat supplied in the case of, or heat transfer in the case of TS diagram, because they are reversible process and they are represented by solid line. On the other hand, the irreversible process are represented as dashed line, as shown on the left of the slide, marked as A. So on the PV diagram as well as on the TS diagram, they are represented as dashed line, and moreover, the area under these lines does not represent the work done as well as the heat transfer for the PV and TS diagram respectively. So I think that is clear that reversible process is represented at solid line and irreversible process is represented as dashed line. And I also told you earlier one thing, that irreversible is not even called as a process. It is merely called as change of state. Process words stand only for reversible ones. But as we are accustomed to use the word process, so we use it like irreversible process and reversible process. So we have seen the irreversible processes in which irreversibilities occurs inside the system or control mass. And also you know that the entropy change of a control mass could be either positive or negative, since the entropy can be increased by internal entropy generation and either increased or decreased by heat transfer, depending upon the direction of that heat transfer. So we consider a process in which quantity of heat is transferred from the surroundings at a temperature T naught. So surroundings is maintained at the temperature T naught, and from that surroundings heat is transferred to the control mass, which is maintained at temperature T. And the work done during this process is del W, means the control mass is doing del W work, and that work is delivered to the surroundings. Now we can say that the change of entropy of control mass, the subscript C dot m dot stands for control mass. So the change of entropy for control mass is greater than equal to del Q upon T. The equality sign stands for the reversible process, whereas inequality sign stands for the irreversible process. Now the entropy change for surroundings is equal to minus del Q upon T naught. And this T naught has to be maintained as constant because it is acting as a thermal energy reservoir, whereas T is variable. Now the total change or the net change of entropy is the summation of the entropy change of the control mass and the entropy change of surroundings. So net entropy change is greater than equal to del Q upon T minus del Q upon T naught. So that gives me the last expression on the slide, that is equation 2.129. Now, if T naught is greater than T, then the second term, that is 1 upon T minus T naught, will be positive. As T naught is greater than T, we can say that heat will flow from surroundings to the control mass. So heat is being given to the control mass or system, it means heat is positive. So del Q is equal to positive. And also 1 upon T minus 1 upon T naught is also a positive quantity. So a positive quantity when multiplied with positive quantity will yield a positive quantity. If T is greater than T naught, then the direction of heat transfer would reverse. Means it will flow from control mass to the surroundings. It means del Q is negative. And also 1 upon T minus 1 upon T naught will also become a negative. So a negative quantity when multiplied with negative quantity will become a positive quantity. So in any case, we are having the value of dS net equal to a positive quantity. So the entropy of an isolated system can never decrease. It always increases and remains constant only when the process is reversible. Means when process is reversible, this dS net becomes equal to zero. So this is known as principle of increase of entropy, and it is basically the quantitative statement of second law of thermodynamics. Sometimes we come across many examples where we feel that entropy is decreasing. For example, if we take an example of a room in which all the articles were scattered, things were lying here and there on the floor, and if somebody is arranging those articles, it means he is making or he or she is making things in order. So definitely one can say that it is leading to the decrease of entropy, because from the disordered room, the room is now changing into an ordered room. So this is basically decreasing the entropy of the room. But here in this case, we have only taken into account the entropy decrease associated with the articles that have been arranged, that have been ordered. But when we have make the things ordered, we have also disturbed the air molecules inside the room. So we have anyhow increased their entropy, because now the air molecules have become disordered. So it may be said that entropy may decrease locally at some region within the isolated system, but it has to be compensated by a greater increase of entropy somewhere within the system. So the net effect of the irreversible process is the entropy increase of the whole system. Means somewhere you can feel that entropy is decreasing, but that entropy decrease is compensated by greater increase of entropy somewhere within the system. So the ultimately the result will be net increase in entropy of the whole system. So one can say that entropy increase of an isolated system or the universe is measure of the extent of irreversibility of the process undergone by the system. So greater the entropy increase, greater is its extent of irreversibility. Now, as we have written the first law, that is energy balance equation for the control volume, in the same way we can write the second law for the control volume. Now the second law for the control mass is written as ds is equal to del q upon t plus del s gen. Now in the form of rate equation, we can write the above equation as shown by the equation 2.134. So here the change of state is occurring from 1 to 2, and for that the change of entropy is s2 minus s1, and that is happening in the time interval del t. So we have written the change of entropy in the form of rate equation as shown by the equation 2.134. Now, as we have considered the control mass, that is fixed mass, and the control volume, as we have shown in the diagram shown on the right side of the slide, during the time del t, the mass del mi enters the control volume across the discrete areas ai, and the mass del mi leaves the system or the control volume across the discrete areas AE. An amount of heat del Q is transferred to the control mass across an element of area where the surface temperature is T, and the work done, that is del W, is being done by the control mass. Now we also assume here that increment of the mass del mi has uniform properties, and similarly the mass del mi has uniform properties. Now we assume the entropy in the control volume at time t equal to be st. So the entropy in the control volume at time t is assumed to be st, where st plus delta t is the entropy in the control volume at time t plus delta t. So s1 is equal to st plus si del mi, that is entropy of the control mass at time t, where s2 is st plus delta t plus se del mi, which is entropy of the control mass at time t plus delta t. Now subtracting these two equations, we get s2 minus s1. So this gives st plus delta t minus st plus se del mi minus si del mi. So here the entropy that is designated by capital letter is the absolute entropy, means entropy in units of kilojoule per Kelvin, whereas the entropy denoted by or designated by small letters is representing the entropy per unit mass. So that will have the unit of kilojoule per kg per Kelvin. So the term SE del ME minus SI del MI represents the net flow of entropy that crosses the control surface during del T as a result of masses del MI and del ME crossing the control surface. While writing the terms del Q upon T and del S gen for a system, one normally considers a quantity of mass at uniform temperature at an instant of time. As we have seen, for a control volume analysis, we deviate from a strictly classical concept of thermodynamics and are prepared to consider a variation in temperature throughout the control volume, the assumption of local equilibrium. Consequently, for the heat transfer term, one must consider each element of the area for the surfaces across which heat flows and the surface temperature of this local area. Therefore, this term must be written as summation of all local del Q upon T terms over the control surface, as shown by the equation 2.136. Now, while considering the entropy generation term, one realizes that this term represents the summation of all local irreversible entropy generations throughout the interior of the control mass at whatever the local interior states are. So, substituting equation 2.135 and 2.136 into 2.134, we have this equation as shown by the equation 2.137. To reduce this expression to a rate equation, we consider what happens to each terms in the equation shown on the last slide as del T approaches 0. The two mass quantities become mass flow rates and the entropy term becomes the time rate of change of entropy in the control volume. The method is analogous to the energy term in the first law equation becoming the time rate of change of energy in the control volume. Similarly, the heat transfer and the generation terms become rate quantities, the first of which is divided by the appropriate local temperature. In utilizing these limiting values to express the rate form of entropy equation for a control volume, one includes summation sign on the flow term to account for the possibility of additional flow streams entering or leaving the control volume. So the resulting expression is basically the expression shown by equation 2.138, which is basically the general expression of the second law of entropy equation. This expression states that the rate of change of entropy inside the control volume plus the net rate of entropy flow out is equal to the sum of two terms, the overall heat transfer surface term and the positive internal irreversibility entropy generation term. Since this second term is necessarily positive or zero, and it is difficult if not impossible to evaluate quantitatively, this equation is frequently written out in the form as shown by equation 2.139, where the equality applies to internally reversible processes and inequality to internally irreversible processes. If there is no mass flow into or out of the control volume and if the temperature is considered uniform at an instant of time, then basically the equation 2.138 reduces to a rate form of control mass entropy equation, that is ds is equal to del q upon t plus del s gen, which we have discussed earlier. And that is written on the bottom of the slide. Now for the steady state steady flow process, there is no change with time of the entropy per unit mass at any point within the control volume, and therefore the first term of the equation 2.138 equals to 0. That is ds cv by del t becomes equal to 0 as shown by the equation 2.140. So that we have the equation 2.141, in which various mass flow rates, heat transfer and entropy generation rates and states are all constant with time. If in a steady state the steady flow process there is only one area over which mass enters the control volume at a uniform rate and only one area over which the mass leaves the control volume at a uniform rate, we can write this equation as shown by the equation 2.142. Now for an adiabatic process with these assumptions, we can say that SE is greater than equal to SI, where the equality holds for a reversible adiabatic process. Now for the uniform state uniform flow process, the second law for a control volume can be written in the following form as shown by the equation 2.144. Now if these terms are integrated separately over the time interval T, we have the following terms as shown on the slide. Therefore, for this period of time T, we can write the second law for the uniform state uniform flow process as shown by the expression 2.145. Since in this process the temperature is uniform throughout the control volume at an instant of time, the integral on the right reduces to the second expression shown on the slide. And therefore, the second law for the uniform state uniform flow process can be written by the equation 2.146. By introducing the internal entropy generation rate, we can write this as an equality Integrating over the time interval t, we have the total amount of internal entropy generation during the process 1s2gen. Therefore, this equation becomes as shown by the equation 2.147. The principle of increase of entropy is one of the most important laws of physical science. It is the quantitative statement of the second law of thermodynamics. Every irreversible process is accompanied by entropy increase of the universe, and this entropy increase quantifies the extent of irreversibility of the process. The higher the entropy increase of the universe, the higher will be the irreversibility of the process. Now we'll discuss the few applications of entropy principle. We are having two reservoirs here, the reservoir A and reservoir B. So there is heat transfer from reservoir A to the reservoir B. Now the reservoir A is having the temperature T1 and the reservoir B is having the temperature T2, and T1 is greater than T2. So the entropy change associated with the reservoir A is minus Q upon T1, whereas the entropy change associated with the reservoir B is Q upon T2. The rod that connects the two reservoirs is undergoing no entropy change because once in steady state, its coordinate do not change. Therefore, for the isolated system, we can say that total entropy change or the entropy change of the universe is equal to the entropy change associated with the reservoir A plus the entropy change associated with the reservoir B. So the total or net entropy change or the entropy of the universe becomes equal to delta S A plus delta S B. So that becomes Q into T1 minus T2 upon T1 T2. If T1 is greater than T2, then entropy change of the universe is positive and the process is irreversible. If T1 is less than T2, then entropy change of universe is negative and the process is impossible. If both the temperatures are equal, that is T1 is equal to T2, then net entropy change or the entropy change of the universe is zero and the process is reversible. Now we are going to discuss another application of entropy principle, that is mixing of two fluids. So we are having two subsystems which are separated by a partition. Now the subsystem 1 is having a fluid of mass m1, specific heat c1 and temperature t1, whereas the subsystem 2 is having a fluid of mass m2, specific heat c2 and temperature t2, and they are basically contained in an adiabatic enclosure. Means subsystem 1 and subsystem 2, they are basically enclosed by an adiabatic enclosure or container. So when the partition is removed, the two fluids mix together, and during this mixing, the equilibrium temperature reached is Tf, and Tf lies somewhere between T1 and T2. And since the enclosure is adiabatic one, the energy interaction is basically confined to the two fluids only. That is, heat given by one fluid is absorbed by the another fluid. So by applying this principle, we get the value of final equilibrium temperature in terms of M1, C1, M2, C2 and T2. That has been shown by the second expression on the slide. Now, the entropy change of the fluid in the subsystem 1 can be calculated with the help of formula dS is equal to del Q upon T. Now, here the heat that is being transferred from the fluid 1 is equal to M1 C1 dT. Because we have assumed that each subsystem is behaving like as if the process is occurring at constant pressure. So when we integrate this expression, we get M1 C1 natural log of Tf upon T1. This will be negative because T1 is greater than Tf. Now the entropy change for the fluid in subsystem 2
delta S2 is equal to del Q upon T. Now the del Q, that is heat interaction here, is also m2 c2 dt. So when this expression is integrated, the entropy change for the fluid in subsystem 2 is equal to m2 c2 into natural log Tf upon T2. This will be positive since Tf is greater than T2. So the total entropy change or the entropy change of the universe will be obtained by adding delta S1 and delta S2. Now if we assume the mixing process to be reversible, that is for sure delta S universe, that is net entropy change or total entropy change, will be positive quantity. Now if for the simplicity if we assume m1 is equal to m2 is equal to m, means each subsystem is containing equal amount of mass, and also if we assume that the specific heat of both the fluids in both the subsystems is bearing the same magnitude, then we can say C1 is equal to C2 is equal to C. So this basically gives us result that the final equilibrium temperature is the average of T1 and T2. So we finally get the result of the net entropy change is equal to 2 into M into C into natural log, where the numerator in the bracket is T1 plus T2 upon 2 and denominator is root of T1 into T2. Now you can see that the numerator is the arithmetic mean of two numbers, that is T1 and T2, whereas the denominator is geometric mean of the two numbers, that is T1 and T2. And for the given two numbers, you know that arithmetic mean is always greater than geometric mean. So definitely it is going to yield us a positive quantity, because M being mass and C being specific heat, they are going to be positive term. Delta S universe is going to be a positive term. Now we want to derive an expression for the maximum work that can be obtained from two finite bodies at temperature T1 and T2. As you know that finite bodies are the bodies to which if heat is transacted or exchanged, then their temperatures are bound to change. Means if heat is given to a body, its temperature will rise, and if heat is taken out from a body, its temperature will decrease. So that is what a thermal body is. Now if two bodies are brought in together into thermal contact delivering no work, that final temperature would be the maximum, and that would be the mean of the arithmetic mean of the two temperatures, that is T1 and T2. Now if a heat engine is operated between the two bodies, means here body 1 is having the temperature T1 and body 2 is having temperature T2 initially. So if a heat engine is operated between these two bodies, then part of heat withdrawn from body 1 is converted to work W by heat engine, and the remainder is rejected to body 2. The lowest attainable final temperature Tf corresponds to the delivery of the largest possible amount of work and is associated with a reversible process. As the work is delivered by a heat engine, the temperature of body 1 will be decreasing and that of body 2 will be increasing. When both the bodies attain the final temperature Tf, the heat engine will stop operating. Let the bodies remain at constant pressure, and that is undergoing no change of phase. So since the bodies are assumed to be maintained at constant pressure, so the total heat withdrawn from body 1, that is Q1, that will be Cp into T1 minus Tf. As you know that for unit mass, the heat transfer during constant pressure process is equal to Cp dt, where Cp is the heat capacity of the two bodies at constant pressure. Now the heat rejected to body 2 that is Q2, that will be Cp into Tf minus T2. Again, as the body 2 is assumed to be maintained at constant pressure, so the heat interaction will be Cp dT. Now, amount of total work delivered by the heat engine will be Q1 minus Q2. So, we get Cp into T1 plus T2 minus 2Tf. Now, for given values of Cp, T1 and T2, as these are the constant quantities, the magnitude of work depends upon Tf, because Tf is acting like a variable, whereas Cp, T1 and T2 are fixed quantities, they are like acting like constants. So the magnitude of work depends upon the Tf. So work obtainable will be maximum when Tf is minimum. So we want to find out the entropy change for the body 1, delta S1, that is del Q upon T, and del Q for constant pressure process will be Cp dT. So now we integrate this term and we get Cp into natural log of Tf upon T1. Now similarly for the body 2, the entropy change is given by again del Q upon T, and del Q is Cp dT. So the expression after integration becomes Cp into natural log of Tf upon T2. Now, since the working fluid operating in the heat engine does not undergo any entropy change, so the entropy change of the working fluid in the heat engine is going to be zero. As you know, that working fluid that is operating in the heat engine is undergoing a complete cycle. And since entropy is a property, so the entropy change for the working fluid that is undergoing a cycle, that will be zero. So applying the entropy principle, the net entropy change of the universe or of the isolated system is going to be positive. So this gives us the expression Cp into natural log of Tf upon T1 plus Cp into natural log of Tf upon T2, which is greater than or equal to 0. So this yields us the expression finally given by the equation 2T1, that is Cp into natural log of Tf square upon T1 into T2, that is greater than or equal to 0. Now, for Tf to be minimum, this term has to be zero. Now, if this term has to be zero, it implies that the bracketed term, that is Tf square upon T1 into T2, that has to be 1. Because you know that log of 1 to any base, that is 0. Now, this gives us Tf is equal to under root of T1 T2. So this gives me the expression for the maximum work, and that is equal to Cp into T1 plus T2 minus 2Tf, and that is becoming equal to Cp into T1 plus T2 minus 2 into root T1 T2. When simplified, this becomes Cp into root of T1 minus root of T2 raised to power 2, or you can say Cp into under root T2 whole square. So the final temperature of the two bodies initially at temperature T1 and T2 can range from Tf is equal to T1 plus T2 with no work to root T1 T2 with the maximum delivery of the work. Now we want to discuss the maximum work that can be obtained from a finite body and a thermal energy reservoir. Thermal energy reservoir is basically a reservoir or a body which has infinite heat capacity. So
We are having a body that is maintained at temperature T and a thermal energy reservoir that is maintained at a temperature T naught. So if heat is exchanged with body, then definitely its temperature is going to change. Whereas heat interaction with thermal energy reservoir is not going to make any change in its temperature. So the temperature of thermal energy reservoir, however, will remain unchanged and it will be maintained at temperature T naught. Whereas the temperature of body will change. If heat is withdrawn from a body, its temperature decreases. So the temperature of body will decrease in this case, and the engine would stop working when the temperature of body reaches T naught. Now, during this period, the amount of work delivered is W and the heat rejected to the thermal energy reservoir is Q minus W. So the entropy change of the body, which is equal to del Q upon T. So del Q is equal to basically Cp dT if we consider body to be maintained at constant pressure. So that gives me the expression Cp into natural log of T naught upon T. Now the entropy change of heat engine will be zero because in the heat engine the working fluid is undergoing a cycle. So the entropy change of either you say working fluid or heat engine, that is going to be zero because the working fluid is undergoing a cycle and entropy is a property. Now the entropy change associated with the thermal energy reservoir is del Q upon T, and the amount of heat exchanged is Q minus W with thermal energy reservoir. So we have put Q minus W upon T naught, and T naught is maintained constant. So the total entropy change will be Cp into natural log of T naught upon T plus Q minus W upon T naught. By the entropy principle, P change of isolated system or the universe has to be positive quantity. So Cp ln T naught upon T plus Q minus W upon T naught, that has to be a positive quantity. So Cp into ln T naught upon T is greater than equal to W minus T naught. So this gives me the value W minus Q upon T naught, that is less than equal to Cp ln of T naught upon T. So by this we finally get the expression W max is equal to Cp into T minus T naught minus T naught natural log of T upon T naught, that is expression 2.133, and that is the maximum work that can be obtained from a finite body and a thermal energy reservoir. We have talked a lot about entropy, and similarly during the first law we talked a lot about energy, and the similarity between these two properties is that it is difficult to define them. It is difficult to define energy as well as it is difficult to define entropy. Now, as we have read in entropy principle that entropy of an isolated system can never decrease, so it follows that only those processes are possible in nature which would give an entropy increase for the system and surroundings together, that is the universe. So basically, we are talking about the direction of process. All spontaneous process that occur in nature, they are possible in one direction only, that is from a higher to a lower potential. Means they will proceed from the higher potential to lower potential. This potential gradient may be that of temperature difference, that may be of pressure difference, or that may be of concentration difference. Now, when the potential gradient is infinitesimally small, or you can say zero, in the limit. The entropy change of the universe is zero and the process is reversible. So when there is finite potential gradient, it is understood that the process is irreversible. So second law basically indicates that in which direction the process will actually take place. So a process always occurs in such a direction so as to cause an increase in the entropy of the universe, entropy of the isolated system. So the microscopic changes ceases means they stops only when the potential gradient disappears and the equilibrium is reached, when the entropy of the universe, that is isolated system, assumes a maximum value. Now we want to discuss what entropy is all about, but before discussing what entropy is or the idea of entropy, we should discuss about some form of energy which are either ordered form of energy or disordered form of energy. Work, as you know, work is a microscopic concept, as we all know. Work basically involves the orderly motion of molecules, whether it is the expansion of the gas or a fluid or the compression of a gas or a fluid. The kinetic energy and potential energy of the system also represent orderly forms of energy. Now the kinetic energy of a fluid or gas is basically due to the coordinated motion of all the molecules with the same average velocity in the same direction. The potential energy is due to vantage position taken by the molecules or displacement of molecules from their normal position. Heat, or you can say thermal energy, is due to random thermal motion of molecules in completely disordered fashion and the average velocity is zero. Now orderly energy can be readily converted into disorderly energy. For example, mechanical and electrical energies into internal energy and then heat by friction and so on. Orderly energy can also be converted into one another, but there are natural limitations on the conversion of disorderly energy into orderly energy as dictated by the second law. When work is dissipated into internal energy, the disorderly motion of molecules is increased. Two gases when mixed represent a higher higher degree of disorder than when they are separated. A reversible process always tends to take the system means isolated system, to a state of greater disorder. It is a tendency on the part of nature to proceed to a state of greater disorder. An isolated system always tends to be in a state of greater entropy. So there is a close link between entropy and disorder. So we can say that entropy of system is a measure of the degree of molecular disorder existing in the system. When heat is given to the system, the disorderly motion of the molecules increases and so the entropy of the system increases. The reverse occurs when heat is removed from the system. In statistical thermodynamics, the property entropy is defined in the terms of probability. The net increase in the entropy that occurs during the irreversible process can be associated with the change of state from a less probable state to a more probable state. For example, a hot cup of tea is lying there on a table in a room. Now the less probable state is that tea is maintaining the temperature as it was having initially till the end of many hours. and the more probable state is that after some hours the temperature of T is equal to the temperature of the room. The second example may be like we are having a compartment in which we are having two portions, and in the one portion we are having gas filled, whereas on the other side we are having vacuum, and that are separated with the help of a membrane. Now if we rupture membrane, then the less probable state will be that gas remains confined to that volume only as it was initially, whereas on the other side vacuum is maintained. Whereas the more probable state is that gas tries to fill the whole volume, even that of vacuum which was initially. So basically we can define entropy as the change of state from less probable state to a more probable state. The definition of entropy that is used more widely is the degree of disorderness or randomness of a system that we have read till the day. Now we have shown various processes on PV diagram, though while doing numerical problems and things we came across the PV diagrams, and we learned quite about how to draw PV diagrams for various processes and various cycles. But even then I like to revise it. For various values of N, polytropic index, we have sketched out the PV diagrams. See, all the processes under the sun, they can be represented by the equation P into V raised to power N, that is equal to constant. If we assume that N may take any value varying from minus infinity to plus infinity. But we know that actually in practical cases, we take polytropic process only for those processes which are having the value of N ranging from 1 to 1.4 or so, means greater than 1 and less than 1.4. Only those processes which are having the value of N greater than 1 and less than 1.4 is practically assumed to be a polytropic process. So now the constant process pressure process having the value of N equal to 0 is represented by a horizontal line, whereas the constant volume process, that is isochoric process, having the value of N equals to infinity, that is represented by a vertical line. Now isothermal process having the value of N equals to 1 is represented by a curved line having a certain slope with x-axis, that is axis on which V is plotted. Similarly, the curve for adiabatic process is lying very close to isothermal process. Now the difference between the isothermal and adiabatic curves is only that adiabatic curve is having higher slope than the isothermal process. So these are the some of the useful curves that we have discussed. Other curves having the value of index minus 2, minus 1 and minus 0.5 are also shown on the slides, but they are seldom used in our numerical problems. Now here we are discussing the TS diagram for various processes. Now for the isothermal process, TS diagram will be represented by a horizontal line. And for the adiabatic process, it is represented by a vertical line, provided if the process is reversible as well as adiabatic, because only that, only then and then it will be isentropic and it can be represented by a vertical line on the TS diagram. Now the constant pressure process having the value of n equals to 0 and the constant volume process having the value of n equals to infinite, they are having certain slope with the x-axis, that is the axis on which entropy is plotted, and they both look somewhat similar, but again there is a difference. Constant volume curve is having more slope than constant pressure curve on TS diagram, and this thing we will get clarified while we will be doing the chapter on Maxwell relations. This is all for the Clausius inequality and the entropy. Thank you.